In this interview, you can meet Kristina Höök. Kristina Höök is a professor in human-machine interaction at Stockholm University. And for many years, Kia has been doing research and designing products in affective computing with her colleagues in her lab in Stockholm. And Kia is the ideal person to ask about how we can apply insights about affective computing when we're designing products. So Kia, can you share some of your main guidelines which you use when you're designing products, which we can also use, of course?
So designing for affect or for emotion in the interaction, I think for a while we had to focus on that particular aspect. And so we made that the main point of the system. But that's stupid because emotion is just part of something else. So if I'm designing for communication between you and me in mm-hmm. this situation, then of course there's emotion, but there's also a lot of other stuff going on. And so I think one of the important things is that emotion or affect needs to be seen as one aspect of the overall problem. So, but this is always the case, right? So you have to go and look at the problem seriously and try to design a good solution that covers it all, and emotion should be one of your concerns in that interaction. So I think that's important. But once you get into that particular aspect of emotion, I think there's a lot we can learn from all the studies people have done from all sorts of fields on what is emotion. From psychology, of course, from sociology, from neurology, and so on. So I think one of the interesting things for me has been to discover the importance of the body, of the physical body mm-hmm. in our emotional reactions. So, for example, by making people move in certain ways, you can actually start emotional processes. Of course, you can't force somebody to have a particular emotional experience just because you make them move in a particular way, but you can perhaps make it more likely that if they play along, they can go into that kind of emotional experience. So there's a lot to learn in that field, from how to interact with your body to sort of spur emotional reactions, but also how to think about emotion as something that is constructed in the interaction over time. So we learned a lot of things like, if you want somebody to act out happiness, it's a short, intense, very energetic thing that you might want to do. While if you act out a sad interaction, it takes longer for the person to get into that kind of experience. Mm. So it's about timing, it's about harmony between the modalities that you use. So if you're using colors or shapes or animations, or if you're using haptics, or if you're using whatever you're using for both input and output, you have to really make sure that they all speak in the same direction, that they're talking about the same experience, the same emotional experience somehow. Or if you make contrasts between them, sort of one modality says happy and another one says something else, then you have to know what you're doing. You have to know that you're consciously really working in that direction. So that's, so harmony between the modalities, looking at timing and really crafting that carefully so that you don't kill people's experiences when they're interacting. And then looking to the literature or the understanding we have of emotion as both a social embodied process, but also a bodily experience, I think is important.
Okay. Are there any things we shouldn't do? Any no-nos? Don't do that.
Yeah. Yeah, so one is this thing with focusing solely on emotion and forgetting about sort of the overall functionality of the system you're trying to do. Another one for me is, I don't like reductionism, I don't like simplification. I don't like when people say, well, I could see that my user was smiling, so that must mean that she liked the food. And therefore, I'm going to rate that food at 5 on a 5-rate scale or whatever. Because that might not at all be what I'm trying to express or what I was feeling. I might be smiling for tons of reasons. I might not even be smiling at all. Maybe I was just making a grimace. You know, that kind of thing. You know, you should not simplify. You need to involve the user in the meaning-making process.
And to talk about the future, what are you going to focus on, and what would you What would your advice be to people in industry as well as people in academia? What should they focus on according to you?
So in my own research, I really want to go even deeper into bodily experiences, and because I think that we have this narrow focus on the visual interactions. So there's always a little screen, and you have symbols and icons, and there's this visual focus. But as I said, since emotion is a social embodied process, it's in your whole body and so on, it seems to me like we should be considering a lot of other ways of expressing and sensing emotion and feeling emotion. So bodily interaction is something that I'm going to work more with, even more with in the future. Communication with yourself, understanding yourself, your own reactions and your own bodily processes. And that's really cool. Very sort of difficult area, but really interesting. Okay. And relating to health applications, you know, emotion is important in things like dealing with diabetes on an everyday basis. But that's research and trying to sort of stay ahead and do stuff before other people have done it. So if I were to turn to industry and say what they could be or should be doing, I think picking up on some of these technologies and some of these possibilities of designing more explicitly for affect or emotion in the interaction, I think is interesting in areas such as games, for example. I think, you know, a lot of games could work with something else than this rising tension and then relief. They have this like cycle. But you know, it's not only about making the tension rise in the game. You could also create for other kinds of emotion, you know, making the user not only frustrated and then catharsis, but forcing them to try and become happy in order to make something happen or whatever, you know. So it's a more complex emotional journey through a game. Or perhaps having complex, interesting characters in the game that do exhibit emotional behaviors and more complex behaviors, I think is interesting. So games is one big area. Another one is obviously communication between people. So all sorts of communication, mobile interaction, ubiquitous Facebook. In Facebook, there's a lot of emotional interaction going on, but none of it is building on the physical.
Mm-hmm. How could it be building on the physical?
We have to work on that, I think. But Facebook is moving out into the world because it's moved into your mobile, and so your mobile you have with you, and in the mobile you have all these sensors and stuff, and there are of course big issues to do with privacy. You know, like Facebook is now actually communicating your location to the system, and this is to a lot of people this is a big thing, and they're leaving Facebook because of it, and so we have to work really carefully on how do we pick up on what users want to express and what of that do you display in Facebook and to whom. But a more physical interaction to express emotional experiences or whatever is interesting.
And again, give them the ability to say, I don't want this part. Like, I don't want people to see my pictures when it's people from my office, for instance.
But that is always important, and it's particularly important if you're trying to express emotion, like, so angry with my boss today. You know, that's like, and you express that strongly, you know. That's maybe not something that you want to display to the whole group of your friends or whatever. So, yeah.
Thank you so much, Kia, for passing on your advice today. And if you want to know more about affective computing, you can read the chapter Kia has written, and you can find this chapter at interactiondesign.org. And here you can also find other chapters written by thought leaders and inventors. And you also have the possibility of watching more videos like this one. And thanks for watching.